Hi, good afternoon. Goedemiddag. Ahlan wa sahlan. And welcome to Bali. Welcome everyone to Blasphemy and Touching the Holy Subject. My name is Baram Sadeghi, and I have the great honor and maybe greater responsibility to be your moderator, your host. Some practical issues. Please don't forget to put your phone on silent mode. Everybody, please. Yes. And we will have a photographer over there, Carl. So he will take some pictures. He will make a video. So if you don't want to be in his video, just raise your hand and he will delete it, because you know, this is, we are all among friends, so there should be no problem with that. And we also record this program for later to watch, and it's also a live stream. So it means that later on during this program, if you have any questions, you really have to speak in the microphone, because otherwise when we are recording it and we are live stream, then we cannot use it, because that's the way people will hear it, and that's the way they don't hear it. So please use the microphone, and it goes also for the members of panel later during this program. So that's the practical issue. Maybe we can see just the main issue of today, like about terminology. Maybe we can see the definition of blasphemy on the screen. Is it possible to see? Yes, that's the definition of blasphemy. So please take 1 second to read it. Can I read out loud? Yeah? Yes, okay. Blasphemy, the action or offense of speaking sacrilegiously about God with capital letter G, mind you, capital letter G, or sacred things, profane talk. So that's blasphemy. In Nederlands, godslastering. The other things that may will talk about, the word is apostasy, afvalligheid, geloofsafval. And one of the other things is haram. And I will tell a little bit about more about haram and later on. So these are the terminology, and something about the background of this of today. In a lot of countries, it's illegal to be or to be identified as an atheist. And although in a lot of countries it's not by the law, they are not outlaw you. Nevertheless, when it comes to a state religion, then it's be illegal to leave your state religion, to do apostasy, which means that you don't believe in the state religion. And some the punishment can be sometimes very harsh, even to death penalty. In 22 countries, they criminalize apostasy, afvalligheid wordt gecriminaliseerd. In 12 of those countries, of 20 countries, it's in principle, you get death penalty when you leave your religion. And those countries are Afghanistan, Malaysia, Maldives, Mauritania, Nigeria, Qatar, Saudi Arabia, Somalia, Sudan, United Arab Emirates, and Yemen, and the place where I am born, in Iran. So in those countries, you get officially death penalty. And for but in Pakistan, which one of the country, one of some of members of panel are from, in Pakistan, is leaving your religion is not forbidden, but blasphemy it is. And now you probably, I'm almost finished. You probably noticed that English is not my first language. Can you, by the way, can you hear me well? Is the, yeah, that, okay, good, good, thank God. Because as someone who is, I hope you will keep this atmosphere for the rest of this meeting, inshallah. And okay, okay. Because, you know, as someone who is born in Iran, spent his first 18 years in Iran, and now living in Holland, I have no idea what my first or second language is. But please bear with me, and if I don't find the right words, maybe you can help your friend for the next 90 minutes. What we are going to do in the next night, but one more thing, you know, now you know everything which is needed to start this evening. You know something about even my own background, you know. But, you know, there are two things in Holland, you know, like holy issues, you know, blasphemy. Two issues in Holland, you don't talk about them in a public atmosphere. You know, especially when it comes, you know, to like, you know, nice things, you know, like nice events like birthday parties, you know, Oud Hollandse verjaardagsfeesten. You don't talk about, first, most important probably is your income. You don't talk about the income. You know, you are not coming to a birth, but hey, how are you? I don't know. What do you make, you know, on a year basis? No, you don't do that. You know, you really ruin the atmosphere. You don't do that. The other thing is about your religious background, you know. Even people, you know, when you look like me, you know, you think maybe he's a Muslim, you know, but you don't ask that. You don't do that, you know. This is something, you know, some people, as a matter of fact, they consider it as a sign of bad manners. If you ask that, it's all that we about need. But since we have an international event here, so I see a lot of people, you know, who look like my, you know, cousins or my nephews, you know, my uncle. People look like me. It's an international event. You know, maybe we can leave that point, and maybe I can ask you those two questions. You know, no, not the question about income. It's really touchy. But the question when it comes to us, you know. Are there any people here with a religious background who have left the religion? May I see some hands in the air? Oh my God, there are a lot of kafirs here. My God, okay. Kafirs in the house. Okay, one more time. Okay, just see, okay, raise your hands. Okay. Oh my God. Okay, okay. Are there any religious people who get really kind of scared? Am I in the right place? Please here, raise your hand. No. Are there any religious people here who are still religious? One, two, three, four. Good. Good for you. Thank you. Okay. Now we really get to know each other. So that's the time that...
Never religious.
Excuse me?
Yeah.
You are never religious. Oh, my God. I want to... Okay. I want a picture with all of you. That's a new people for me, you know. No religious at all. Oh my God. Oh my God, there is a special place for you in the hell. Next to my place, next to my place. You are among friends. Okay. Okay, having said that, I would like to ask, first we will have a lecture here, about 50 minutes. And when I say 50 minutes, I really mean, you know, Dutch 50 minutes, you know, 1:05. Okay, if it goes to 1:06, it's okay. When it goes to 1:07, I will ask our technician, you know, to cut the sound, okay? Okay, having said so, we will have a lecture by a lawyer from Pakistan, Saif Al Malouk. He was defending the Christian lady Asiya Bibi or Asiya Nurin, otherwise. And that case we probably know, remember still. And otherwise, Saif will tell us something about that. He came to even to Holland, spent some time in Holland, even in my hometown, Rotterdam. And on that note, I will ask Saif to go over there and start this lecture. And as I said, 15 minutes. Saif, please.
So, first of all, it's not a lecture. It's not a classroom. It's the intellectual adult people's gathering. I'm just here to share with you that firstly, what is the blasphemy laws and how they are being practiced in Pakistan. And although all of you have heard Asiya Bibi, she got prominence around the world 9 years when she was arrested on the allegations of blasphemy. And then that I'm doing some other cases, maybe find time, then I come to. First of all, what is the blasphemy? What they wrote here, that may be from dictionary, that is correct definition, but in law, the main offense of blasphemy in Pakistan is codified in the Pakistan Penal Code as Section 295C, which says that anybody who talks anything disrespectful in respect of the Muslim's Prophet Muhammad, peace be upon him, shall be treated as blasphemous. And the sentence for the defense has been death sentence only. So this is the blasphemy. And the second portion of blasphemy is anybody who defiled the holy book of Muslims, namely Quran, turns it, do something disrespectful, that is also now codified offense and is punishable by life imprisonment. So now I'll give a very short introduction of Asia Bibi. Asia was a Christian woman living in a far flung village, about 70 kilometers from the main city of Lahore, and the only family in the whole village of Muslim, which was a Christian, living since partition, since creation of Pakistan 1947, having always good relation with the whole of the village. So what happened in 2009, when she was working as a field worker in a garden for plucking the fruits, there was about 25 Muslim women who would work with her. And on a lunch break, Asia is bringing a jug of water for the co-workers to drink. And two of them, Muslim, refused to drink, saying that they will not drink water from the hand of a Christian. And it is from the record that some quarrel ensued between those Muslims women and Asia Bibi. They abuse each other. Now the Muslim women came with a version that Asia abused the Muslim Prophet Muhammad, peace be upon him. So a case was registered against her. Now, I'm practicing as a lawyer for 38 years, almost whole of my life. I say the investigators, the lawyers, the judges, they should have no religion once they are working, once they are discharging their duties. But it is very, very unfortunate, and it has come to my experience, that all of them, right starting from the police job is, whenever there's a crime is reported, they are the face of the state. They act as state. And they have to give an opinion after collecting evidence for and against the, whether the allegation is correct or not. But when it comes to the blasphemy cases, everyone wants paradise. And it is such an unfortunate aspect that most of the Muslims, they think that the paradise would come only once you stand up for protecting the respect of the Prophet. Although, to my personal mind, the God in the Quran said, if you kill one innocent, that means you have killed whole the humanity. This is the God is saying. Then the Prophet Muhammad said, it is much better to leave 99 who are guilty instead convicting one innocent. So, but in case of Asia Bibi, she was so unlucky that right from the investigating police, they wanted paradise. They did not investigate the case as per their legal duty as state representative. They came to the conclusion that yes, the allegation is correct. And the second stage starts that the police files the challan before the court, and then there's a judge, district judge, who has to call the witnesses, record evidence, and then give the judgment. That judge, particularly that judge, Javed Iqbal was his name, he met me when I was Asia's lawyer and case was still pending. In the Lahore I Court building, he had come for some personal job. So when he came to know that I'm the lawyer of Asia Bibi, he introduced himself to me with a much pride like this, because sir, I'm the judge who has sentenced Asia Bibi to death. Sir, you know I've sentenced another 4 or 5 persons to death, the Christians. And you know, sir, I'm receiving letters of appreciation from various religious organizations. So this lost my self-control, and I gave him a shut-up call, and I told him, behave like a judge. So, I mean, this is the background. That judge also, without going through the evidence that case is proved or not, he sentenced her to death. And then it came to the High Court, the Court of Appeal, and there the case was given to the two judges. One of them was still yet to be confirmed. And it is very, very unfortunately that such an important case, where whole the world is looking on that case, that that has to be allocated to a judge who is yet not confirmed. And the second member of that bench, the judge of the High Court, was a very, very weak personality man. Because to decide such a most controversial cases of the world, you need a very strong judges. So they also dismissed her appeal, quoting wrong provisions of law, quoting wrong precedent of the Supreme Court of Pakistan. So Asia was unlucky. She born in a very, very poor family. She worked for how much? For 30 penny of a euro, a per day wages. Having two daughters, she fell in love with a man to whom she married, who was already married, having 5 children. And now her husband continued enjoying his life when she was in the prison, receiving a lot of dollars from abroad, building bungalows for his first wife's children, having going to America, going to England, la 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 la. But she was suffering. And the other aspects of blasphemy cases in Pakistan is that this is a touchy topic. So no good lawyer want to indulge in such like cases, because in this case, the mullah, the people who were opposing Asia Bibi, they crossed all the limits. They threatened the Supreme Court judges that if they acquit Asia Bibi, accept her appeal, we'll kill those judges. And this they were saying on television, this they were saying in public gathering, this they were saying in the press. So hats off to the judges of the Supreme Court of Pakistan, that in this atmosphere, they stood by their oath, they stood with the Constitution, and they stood by the law, and they found, and they declared that allegations brought against the Asia Bibi were false. They did not say that prosecution has not proved its case. They said the allegations were false. And they wrote that in future, if any case comes before them where they find that the allegation was false, they'll prosecute all those witnesses. And they'll sentence them with the same punishment of death which is applicable to the blasphemy case. So, after her acquittal, the religious people had took over the whole Pakistan, roads were closed, and the country went to standstill for 3 days. And then I had to fly to out of the country. And incidentally, without planning, I landed in Amsterdam. And I spent about 3 months here. And let me express, which I'm saying everywhere where I go, I said, if someone wants to see a portion of paradise on the ground of this world, they should go to Netherlands. In my evaluation and experience, the Dutch people are innocent, harmless, humble, and always ready to help, and wonderful people. I had a very good time here. So they offered me, rather they granted me permanent residence with my family to live for whole life here. But when the ASIA's review petition was fixed before the Supreme Court on 29th January 2019, I asked the government of Netherlands to give me a special permission to visit to defend our case. They said, according to our rules, you cannot go to Pakistan for 5 years. And I had to surrender that permanent residence back to the Netherlands government. And I went back and I fought our case. And so I'm doing a couple of other cases on the blasphemy in Pakistan. Many friends ask me, why you're putting your life in danger? And I said, somebody has to come forward to help those nobody is helping. So now there's a second Christian woman on death row on the blasphemy charges, namely Shugufta, along with her husband. Now I've taken her case, and I'm sure that very soon I'll bring her out also one day. And why I'm here today, I must salute to one of my ideal women, Maryam Namazi. She always helped me, provided me chances, whether it's in England, whether it's in Netherlands, whether it's, so I'm here because of her. Thank you, Maryam. Thank you very much.
Please stay. Mariam, would you please stand up so people can see you? So that's the lady who we're talking about. So that's Mariam, okay. Okay. Saif, before you leave us, just a couple of questions. When you arrived in Holland at that time, I can remember that you were afraid to go back to Pakistan. But what is the situation right now? Are you living in Pakistan, and do you feel comfortable? Do you feel safe over there?
Number one, I never wanted to leave Pakistan. It was my friends, diplomats of Western world, who thought that for a shorter period, I should leave that place so that the things go cool. I want to live in my own country with a pride and with a job which I'm doing, and the people who needs me for all these cases. I'm for them. My life is for them. It's not for me. People die with cholera, with heart attack, with accidents. Then why not to die doing something good? That is how I believe, and that is my strength. And people like Maryam, they are my strength. They always encourage me. They always stand behind.
Okay, great, great, great. Nevertheless, I'm going to repeat my question. Do you feel comfortable in Pakistan? Do you feel safe over there?
I'm very comfortable, and okay. Government of Pakistan has provided me the police security who round the clock stays with me. And I'm a believer, and I feel that the day your life ends, which is determined by the God, you have to leave.
Yeah.
So maybe mode of death can be different.
Yeah.
So you go by accident, you go by heart attack, or you go by going by the fires of fundamentalists. That is the model going which I would love to go like that.
Okay. Yeah. By believer, you mean you are a Muslim? Yes.
Of
you're
course,
Muslim.
Some.
Okay. Yeah, you are a Muslim. Okay. Okay. So, you were Asia's lawyer from the first day.
No. I was Asya's lawyer when she had lost all the hopes. She had been sentenced to death by the trial court. Her appeal has been dismissed. And whole the world thought, no, she'll never come back.
Yeah.
So I was in the last court, the Supreme Court of Pakistan.
Yeah.
So and for 5 years I fought.
Eventually she stayed 8 years in the prison. Am I right?
Yeah? 9 years.
9 years, my God. Yeah. And now she's living in Canada.
Yeah, no, she's living in Canada.
Yeah. Yeah, you are. And she's living there with her children?
Yeah, she has two daughters.
Yeah.
One is mentally distorted,
yeah.
And the other is totally uneducated, didn't go to school, and so. With husband and these two daughters.
Okay. On that note, I will leave you. Of course, the most important question, which is everybody's mind, is who were those nice, humble, harmless, open-minded Dutch people you met? But we will come to that question. Because, you know, tell us, where do they live? You know, I want to meet them as well, you know. But with that question, we will come back. So if you have any questions for Saif, he will come back at the end of this evening. We will have about 20 minutes for Q&A. So for now, I thank you so much
so
for being here.
Before I leave,
yeah,
I take 30 seconds.
Okay.
And as this conference was talking about rights and violation of rights and discriminations and all that. So I say the whole behavior of the civilized world is always based on political philosophies. So today the mayor came and she spoke about the rights of the Hong Kong Russian peoples. But nobody talks about 10 million Kashmiri people who are living in the held Kashmir. And this is the fourth week ending. There's a curfew. They don't have food to eat. They don't have medicine. The kids can't go out. And neither the America, nor the European Union, nor the Netherlands, nobody talks. So I'd been asked by a number of people, Kashmiris from around the world, that I should raise their voice before this forum. So I've done my duty. So thank you very much.
Okay, great. Great. Sit over there. Thank you so much. Thank you so much. Okay. I will start a panel discussion. I will ask Nadia, Sarah, and Rishvin to join me here, please. Come on here, please. Yeah. Come here. Please. Take a microphone, take a microphone. Okay, Nadia, in the middle, Nadia. Filmmaker from Tunisia, and she made a film about a revolution in her home country, Tunisia. And after that, she was not allowed to go back to country, and now she's now going there. We will talk about that later. And then Sarah. Pakistani-American writer, speaker, and political activist. You left Islam when you were 16 years old? Mm-hmm. Yeah, that's right, okay, 16 years old. Co-founded the group Ex-Muslims of North America, or as you pronounce it, Ex-Menia? How do you pronounce it?
That's the acronym, right? Ex-MNA is how we say it. I mean, it doesn't really come off the tongue very easily.
But
ex-Muslims of North America.
Ex-Muslims of North America, yeah. And Rishwin, you just 2 days ago you arrived in Holland. Am I right?
Yeah, 3 days ago.
Yeah, from Sri Lanka. You are an ex-Muslim from Sri Lanka, and you survived an attack on your life. Am I right?
It wasn't an attack. It was a murder attempt. Two times.
Attempt. Yeah.
Yes.
Two times. Yeah. And Rishwin. Let me start with you. When did you become an ex-Muslim, and why, when, and why are you so, let's say, outgoing, so public about that?
Well, I ask your last question first, why I am so public, because okay. I am the only and first ex-Muslim in Sri Lanka to come out of public with my real name and real identity. Not only in Sri Lanka, in the southern part of India, they speak the language called Tamil, that is 99% of the Sri Lankan Muslims also speak the same language. So I am the only one with the real name, real identity, presenting constructive criticism about Islam in the Tamil language.
Yeah.
So, I come to my story, this, your first question,
yes.
Why I left and...
Yeah, why?
Yeah, I was born to a secret atheist father and a moderate mother. My father never went to masjid unless he had no other choice. As far as I remember, he lived 30 years when I was, sorry, 29. When I was 29, he passed away. During this 29 years period, I have seen him going to masjid only 3 times. That was after we were expelled from our hometown in Sri Lanka from Jaffna in 1990 because we were Muslims, burned Muslims. So that time we had to stay with some other people in other towns. So the people who gave us shelter were Muslims. So that because father could not avoid this situation. So he went 3 times. Other than that, I have never seen my father going to masjid. And my mother told me my father didn't even try to do the circums.
Besnijdenis, yeah.
Yeah. So, but my grandmother only insisted him he should do that one to me when I was 5 years old or 6, I can't remember. So, he didn't ask me, or he didn't send me to the masjid for prayer or anything, but it was my maternal uncle who took me to the masjid.
Rishwin, are you by saying that, are you blaming your father that you became an ex-Muslim?
No, of course not.
Okay, let me ask you again. Why did you leave your religion?
It was in the later part, much later. I left it in 2013. I'm talking about 1980s.
Okay,
I will come slowly. I'll catch up.
Okay,
you have to excuse me. This is my first such seating.
Okay.
So I don't know, I try my best.
Oh my God, I love.
So since it's my first seating, I may try to take more time. So you both have to excuse me.
No, I'm not. I'm the timekeeper.
Oh, yeah.
Yeah,
okay.
So now I'm
so
going to Nadia.
So then I have an eye on you.
No, I'm going to Nadia, Rishwin, yeah? With your permission, of course, yeah? I'm going to Nadia, okay? Nadia, yeah. Would you please tell us something about the film you made, and especially the backlash of the film, Neither Allah Nor Master, or as they call it, correct me if I'm wrong, Laïcité, Inshallah?
Yeah.
I love that title. I love it, Laïcité, Inshallah. My God. Why? When? How? And what happened after that?
Neither
Yeah, could just keep talking and they put it on.
Neither Allah Nor Master, it's the first title. Mm-hmm. But I was working, when I was shooting in Tunisia, My first choice was disobedience.
Uh-huh.
It's because I started when it was a dictatorship in Tunisia.
Yeah.
And I started to film, you know, during Ramadan.
Uh-huh.
I wanted to film the people who were disobedient, you know, to Ramadan in Tunisia.
Yeah.
Because there is no law in Tunisia to oblige people to make Ramadan.
Yeah.
But now it's something like the society doesn't accept, you know, the people who don't fast, you know, during Ramadan. So I decided to go in August 2010 to make this movie, and I lied to the subject, you know, to Ben Ali. And
the former president?
The dictator.
The dictator, as they call it, yes.
And during the editing of the movie, you know, the revolution happened, and I decided to go back to Tunisia because I was already in Paris.
Yeah.
And I decided to go back to Tunisia and film all this movement of revolution, you know, and all these young people and also of my generation asking for laïcité. I know, here you said secularism. Sorry, I don't understand what does it mean, you know. For me, laïcité, it's a principle who separates the religion from the state.
From the state, yes.
Like in Turkey.
Yeah.
Because we have to remember that Turkey is the only laic country in the Arab, in the Muslim world, you know. And so I made this movie, and I decided to call it, you know, Neither Allah Nor Master. So we screened it in Tunisia at the premiere in Tunis. And when I went out from the screening, so it was really a mondial international premiere, and with my producer, French producer, and I said, you know, it's after revolution, 3 months after.
So it
and
was
I,
quite
I said to my
freedom.
Producer, you see, it's the only country in the Muslim world you can make a movie with the title Neither Allah Nor Master and go out and don't be killed in the street, you know. But, you know, 2 days after on Facebook, it was another story.
Yeah.
And, of course, you know, all the Islamists make a big, you know, campaign against me and asking for my death, of course.
Yeah. Yeah.
And 2 months after, when there were another screening of the movie, and the title was already changed because the distributor in France were afraid about this title in France, you know, and they asked me to change the title. They said, we never can release a movie with this kind of title in France, you know. They will destroy cinema and everything.
Yeah.
So I decided to call it, you know, Laïcité Inshallah. It was like, you know, a joke for me, because for me, Neither Allah nor Master or Laïcité Inshallah, it's the same ironic, you know, sentence, you know. And they destroyed the cinema and the Salafists in Tunisia.
Yeah.
And at this time, three lawyers, you know, from Ennahda, the Islamist party in Tunisia, they put, you know, charge against me, six charge against me in Tunisia, and I risk 5 years of jail. And I was, you know, for 7 years, I could not go back to Tunisia because of this.
Yeah.
And now the story.
That's the story, yeah. And now you are able and feel comfortable enough to go to Tunisia?
Yeah.
Cool.
Comfortable, you know. I think I don't have any more desire, you know, to go to Tunisia. But I go, of course, because I've got my family, my friends, all my life.
Yeah.
And I'm happy when I'm in Tunisia, you know, speaking my language.
Yeah.
And, you know, everything, you know. I love this country, of course, but now it's so difficult for me to go to Tunisia, yes.
Yeah, okay. Mm. Sarah, you are born in Pakistan, am I right? Yeah?
Yes.
And but you are raised in the United States.
Yes.
And you left your religion when you were 16 years old. Tell me something about your near surrounding, let's say your family.
Mm-hmm.
How did they react upon your apostasy? Could you please tell us when?
I consider myself relatively privileged from that perspective, in the sense that unlike most of the people that I work with now, with ex-Muslims from North America, or not most, but many of the people that I work with, I didn't have a threat of abuse or, you know, or disowning from my family. It was quite difficult for the first couple of years, I think. And it's very understandable for my parents. My parents were believers, true believers. I was a real believer. And
you even wore hijab.
For a short period of time, and I chose to wear it.
Yeah.
To wear it when I was younger, I was convinced that this was the right path. This yeah. was what God commanded of me, yeah. and in order for me to follow His path the best way that I could, that this was something that I needed to do. So that was something that I put on myself, and my parents were kind of amused at the idea.
Yeah.
But when I started to have doubts and discuss them, and I think it was a really severe shock for my parents. And I think a real sense of fear in their hearts, because they, as believers, were now seeing somebody they loved very much fall astray and possibly walk a path that would lead her to eternal damnation and torment, right? And of course, for any loving parent, that's a horrific thing to see your child go through. But over the years, we discussed it, many, many long conversations and my mother's tears. But eventually, I think we've come to some sort of an understanding.
Sarah, let me get that clear. Were they afraid that after this life, the eternal life would be, you will end up in the hell? Or were they afraid of what happens in this life to you?
Right, both.
Both.
Yes, certainly both. And then especially that latter part about what would happen to me in this life. At first, before I co-founded Ex-Muslims North America, it was just, what will everyone else think? Will she ever get married? What will happen to, you know, the community and what they think about her? So it was more honor-based fear. Then now it's a fear for my life because of my activism yeah. and what I do.
And they are still believers?
My mother still believes-ish, but my father no longer believes, which is
because
incredible.
Of you.
Yeah, I think
yeah.
so.
Yeah. yeah. I read some stories that you kind of, you know, had impact on him, you know, the other way around, you know,
right.
what happened?
Right.
What did it go wrong?
I mean, yeah, right, exactly.
The child where did he? Yeah.
But, you know, I mean, and that, it gives me so much hope to see the effect that, you know, people have on their family relations, what I had on my father and what my father continues to have on other people around
yeah.
him, because he's able to reach his peers okay. in a way that I couldn't reach, you know, my uncles or my, you know, extended family members. But he can speak to them. So okay. it's an incredible thing. It really just spreads like a virus almost, but yeah. you know, in a good sense.
Good
but,
virus, yeah, but. Good virus, yeah, okay. Final question, and then we'll have a short break, musical break. Final question for you. What does your NGO, your organization do mm-hmm. for ex-Muslims?
Right, so I co-founded Ex-Muslim North America now 6 years ago. Wow, that feels like a long time. But
with Mohammed Sayed.
With Mohammed Sayed, who's right there.
Where is the Mohammed? Oh, you are Mohammed. Okay. Mohammed, okay. Congratulations, Mohammed, with your organization. So yeah. tell us something about
yeah.
what you
so
do.
So he was actually the first ex-Muslim I ever met, and I didn't believe him because I had spent years and years not telling anybody that I didn't believe, because I just didn't think it was possible that there would be people from my background who could also not believe. So when he told me, I was like, I don't, okay. and then when we found the organization, it started as a community building grassroots organization. We realized the need for ex-Muslims to be in a social space together, to be able to see other people
yeah.
and see that you're real and you're real and you're not crazy.
Yeah.
So maybe I'm not crazy.
Yeah.
And we knew the power of social connection and mm-hmm. belonging. And we know that ex-Muslims are completely, if we don't even have the right to life in much of the world. So, you know, the idea that we could even find social connection through, you know, as people who don't believe, this was something unique and new And so we knew that we had to foster these kinds of communities, and they have their special challenges, security concerns, of course, that are pretty severe. But now we have community groups, I think 25 in across the United States and Canada. Yeah. We produce mini documentary series that are on our YouTube channel to highlight ex-Muslims and show who they really are, you know, the different kinds of apostates, where they come from. Yeah. We've done campus tours, and now we're doing some research about, you know, who ex-Muslims really are and what the nature of apostasy is like.
Cool. As I said, we will have a short break. And so it means that we are going to, I will ask you to leave the stage to stay over there, or maybe you can go back to your own place and then come back in 2 or 3 minutes, okay? Thank you so much for right now, okay? Please leave. Okay. And we will have a special performance by Veedu Vidz. Veedu, where are you? Would you please join me here? Okay. Master, come here. Yes, please. Okay. Okay. Veedu, thank you so much for being with us. Are you going to use the microphone, or are you going to do it? Mike, okay. Take that microphone, please. And the title of your song is Music is Haram.
Yes.
So, of course, for the people with the Islamic background, they understand, you know, the fucking irony of it. But just for two other people, you say, what was it? You know, you have halal, you have haram. What is haram? And how haram is music?
Very.
Okay, please, tell us something about it. What is music is haram? What is the background?
Yeah, so I've got a YouTube channel called Veedu Vidz.
Please.
I've got a YouTube channel called Veedu Vidz, and I make satire comedy videos, and I'm a big fan of music like many people are. But one of the constant things you always hear in Islam is that music is haram. Yeah. No matter if it's an instrument or this or that, it's completely haram.
Yeah.
So I think, you know, the definition of haram is technically what is forbidden, you can't have it, it's wrong. But it seems like the more practical definition of haram is anything that's fun. Anything that makes you human, anything that you enjoy. It's haram.
Yeah.
So okay. I wanted to make a song that would celebrate how haram music is.
Yeah. Okay. Yeah. On that note, I will leave the stage and
sure.
I will see you.
Just quickly, okay. If halfway through the song, I change my voice and imitate someone in a very strong Indian accent. If you're like, maybe he's got some sort of mental disease, but I'm imitating a character or a speaker called Dr. Zakir Naik, who speaks like this.
Oh, yeah.
So just bear that in mind.
Yeah.
So instead, like, why is he changing his voice all of a sudden?
Yeah. Cool. It's not because of you hate Indian people.
No. I would never do that.
No, not in public. No.
Okay. Behind closed doors. Yeah.
Okay. Vidz, stay here.
Thank you very much. Thank you. And by the way, if you know the lyrics to the song, please sing along. The chorus is, "Music is haram. Everybody knows it penetrates your body from your head to your toes. Music is haram. Everybody knows it."
Yeah.
Go for it. Let's see how this works. Yeah. Check it. Listen.
It's Rex.
Yeah. It's Veedu Vidz on the mic. Given that I work every day and every night, gonna break it down for all you people. Got logical proof that music is evil. Music messes minds and makes you tipsy. Look at Gaga, look at Britney, look at 50 and look at Wifty. There ain't no denying, bruv. You get me? Classical, jazz, reggae and pop, R&B, country, Bollywood and rock. They're all so addictive when the beat drops. You better not listen to them, full stop. Yeah, music magic turns man into a monster. It will leave your head scarred like Harry Potter. But don't worry, bro, you know that I got ya. If you're feeling ill, let me call you the doctor. Music is haram, everybody knows. It penetrates your body from your head to your toes. Music is haram, everybody knows. It penetrates your body from your. Music is haram, everybody knows. It penetrates your body from your head to your toes. Music is haram, everybody knows. It penetrates your body from your... But to ask a very good question. Listen up close, pay attention. Singing and dancing is irresistible, but the emphasis is completely impermissible. I've analyzed and memorized every single song, and the message music sends is totally wrong. Satan distracts, enemies lead. He whispers in your ears and nullifies your deeds. String instruments are not permitted. Women wearing clothes that are too fitted. 50 cent or 50 rupees. It's time to pray, so get on your knees. Turn off the music and listen to me. In chapter number 5 and verse 33. Book number 8. paid 77. If you do what I say, I will take you to heaven. Music is haram, everybody knows. It penetrates your body from your head to your toes. Music is haram, everybody knows. It penetrates your body from your head to your toes. Music is haram, everybody knows. It penetrates your body from your head to your music is haram, everybody knows. It penetrates your body from your head to your toes. Thank you. Thank you, guys. Thank you. Thanks so much. Thank you.
Thank you so much.
Thank you.
Let's go back to it. Okay, thank you. May I ask the members of FNAL to come back here, please? Okay. Yes. By the way, Fitz, I went to YouTube to watch it, to read some of the replies of people, the reactions, and of course there are a lot of nice remarks about that. But there are some people who said, so it is the proof that you are with the Yahudi, and how much money are you paid to mock Islam? How much money? And of course you are a pig. So, and I want to ask a question for you, and especially you as a filmmaker. With, as I said, you know, this is the title, the everything, you know, so nice. How important, this is a question for all of you, how important to do your thing, do your message, doing it through music or, and especially irony or satire? How do you see that? How the importance of that? Or maybe what are the dangers of that? Or the plus and the minus, the pros and cons of it? Was it a good question?
Specifically working through jokes and satire?
Satire, you know, to mock a religion or Islam religion. How important is it? How do you see that? You know, the you for both?
I think, yes, my titles, you know, are always ironic, you know, and you can take it as serious and also... Yeah. They understood, you know, very well the message. The Islamists, and they wanted to show the limits, you know, that you cannot go through. But yes, I think with the humor, you know, you can pass a lot of things, and it's. But now I think, because my first movie, it was a very short movie, 5 minutes, you know, showing two women making a man body, you know, with clay.
Yeah.
And it was really well received in 1990 in Tunisia. I think now nobody understand no more humor, you know, and there is no time for that. Yeah. And they want to tell us, you know, that there is something, it's serious, you know, and... It's why we have to continue, you know, to make joke about them, and like Charlie Hebdo, and that's great.
Sarah, what's your take?
What's wonderful about humor is that I don't know how to phrase it, but a coercive nature to laughter, in that when you find something funny, you can't help it. It just bubbles out of you. There's that laughter. There's that smile. You can't help it. You feel it. And you reveal when you laugh and when you smile and when you just let it out, you reveal that you've seen an element of truth in the depiction and in the satire and in the humor. And so there's something about the connection of what humor is and what good humor is, and its connection to telling real truths that we might be too uncomfortable to admit, we wouldn't want to talk about in any other circumstance. But with humor, we can bring it out, and it just comes and bubbles up to the surface. So there's something, you know, I think that in societies where humor is no longer something that is tolerated, where satire and ridicule and all these things are no longer welcome, dissent is soon not welcome, if you know, not welcome at all in that context.
How about you, Shirin?
Well, I think Islam doesn't like arts. except poem. Most formats of the arts are prohibited in Islam, other than poem, because Muhammad claimed himself that the Quran is a poem in Arabic. I don't know, I'm not Arabic, it's not my mother tongue. But most music, drawings, movies, acting, most formats of the arts are prohibited in Islam. Muhammad might have guessed those days that art could destroy what he is trying to build up.
Yeah, yeah.
So it's doing now. Yeah. And we saw that one a while ago.
Yeah. I like the fact that while you are telling that, you are smiling while you are saying that. It's, you know.
Oh, thank you. Yeah. Thank you very much.
I like your expression. Okay. By the way, sometimes, you know, it's in a way maybe important, you know, to put yourself to in other man's shoes, in their position. So if I ask you, why is so important for them, for the Muslim people, in your case, for example, not to be criticized? What are they afraid of? What will, you know, you understand? Why are they so against the way you act, do? What they have, what's their...
They are afraid about freedom, you know? I think all the religions, they are afraid about freedom, because when you are free, you can think, you know, about yourself, and you can be... You can see everything, you know, with a critical view, and you can questioning, you know, all the, those holy books and all those laws, you know, that are not civil laws, you know. And I think the most important now it's to be together, all of us, not only those people coming from Muslim countries or Muslim culture or everything, but all together, you know, to have only civil states, you know. Yeah. And it's the only way, you know, to get democracy everywhere, because we see that all those theocracy, you know, Arab and others, you know, they are not democratic. And this is the only way, you know. And they know if we are free, it's becoming Tunisia when the revolution happens, you know. All the people around the world, they were surprised, you know, to see that Arab people, oh, strange, they also want freedom. Yeah, of course, you know. I think all the people want freedom, but sometimes they cannot express, you know, this thing. So we have to be together for that.
Okay. I will have just one more two questions for you. Good, good, good. And then there will be room for the audience to ask some questions. And especially, maybe I should emphasize a question with a question mark. Yeah, you know what I mean, yeah? So not telling the story of your PhD like that or a story, just a question with a question mark. Having said, just one question. I don't know, you know, while I was preparing this conversation today, you know, mind thing, you know, I couldn't put my finger on that point, that in those countries, when they have these laws regarding blasphemy or apostasy, it's because for them, those notions are like the glue of their culture, the country, the state. It's so important for them that they put it in front, and they even put law on it. And in one way or another, I understand that, you know, even here in Holland, we have some laws regarding insulting other people. For example, you cannot insult the king of Holland, because probably they think that institution, the king, kingdom of Holland, it's the glue of our country. So in a way, you know, one way or another, you know, you understand what I mean? I understand that, you know, that they prohibit you or you to leave your religion or to do blasphemy, to insult their prophet, because it's so important for them. Do you understand what I mean, or shall I delete this?
Yeah, I understand.
Okay, please, what's your thought about that?
Okay, you said about criticizing queen or king in Holland. Yeah. If somebody doesn't like to live in Holland, is he free to move to another country?
Yeah. Yeah. That's the big difference.
Yeah, but if you don't like Islam, why aren't you free to move out of to Islam?
Yeah, okay.
No, I mean, I don't think that Holland law is a very good law.
Yeah.
I mean, in a democracy, especially if you have a country where it is the people who are in power, you have to be able to criticize, mock, satirize the people in power, whoever they may be, and in any institutions, right? Everything can be improved upon. Everything can be something we can work to better. And the way that we do that is by criticism. It starts first as a blasphemy, as a form of dissent, something that people will probably rile up against and be upset, you know, how dare you criticize this? This is so important to us. But that's how we improve as a society. That's how we progress. That's how we get to something as stable and wonderful as many Western democracies that we have now, by the process of criticism, by the process of challenging the most powerful people, the authorities.
Institutions.
In power, yeah.
Okay, so what's your take on it?
But you said, you know, insult the king.
Yeah.
But for a lot of people in Muslim countries, can say that, you know, because I have to take a lot of, precaution to talk.
For your strength, actually,
I don't know how to say it. Precaution, to say that, you know, but... In Islam, you when you criticize, it's an insult, you know? It's not the same, you know? This is the difference.
Yeah.
Because I don't like to insult anybody, you know? And tomorrow you will see my movie, and I am not insulting anybody. But I was accused, you know, to insult the Prophet. I'm not talking about the Prophet. In only 1 minute in my movie, you know, I was accused to insult all the Muslim people, you know, but I'm not talking about them. I'm just talking about the one who doesn't want to fast in Ramadan, you know. So criticism, make a critic, you know, about something coming from the Quran
by
is an
nature,
insult
by its
from
nature
the,
is
from
the,
those Islamists, you
That's
know.
That's a big difference.
But you have a lot of Muslim people, you know, and I don't want to call them moderate. I don't understand what it means, you know, some people who believe in moderate. No, you have believer and you have fanatics, you know, so it's different. But moderate, it doesn't mean nothing for me, you know. But they don't feel insulted when you tell them, I don't believe in God, you know?
Yeah.
But those Islamists, because they want to take the power, the politic power, they make, you know, rules that you don't have to transgress, you know?
Yeah.
And there is no, in Tunisia, I mean, it's not a law, but they use this terrorism, you know, because for me, it's terrorism. It's not only when they put a bomb and when they kill you. It's always when they show, you know, to a filmmaker or to a writer or to a painting, you know, that this is the limit.
Yeah.
And this is terrorizing all the people, because the people around are not able, you know, to have the courage, you know, to say no to them. But if we are... many of us, you know, rising on our feet and saying no to these people, maybe tomorrow they will join us and not stay silent in front of them.
Cool. Okay. Our first speaker, he showed that he could fight in a country like Pakistan, fight a specific case about blasphemy. But my question for you is, do you think it's possible, the countries you know a little bit about, your background, is it possible to fight blasphemy laws by nature? Is it possible to do that, to try to delete them, the law itself, for example, in Pakistan or in Sri Lanka, or in Tunisia? How do you see that, the chances of that?
I come from a country where Muslims are around 10%. So we don't have any blasphemy or apostasy laws.
Okay.
But still, the school textbooks issued by the government free of charge to the school kids had a section where it is mentioned leaving Islam is punishable by killing, not by death penalty. The word used, killing or assassination. Yeah. So it was there for 35 years in the school textbooks. Yeah. So finally they removed it.
Okay.
So there is going to be an inquiry.
Cool.
How it happened, yeah. But it may take time.
Okay. Let me ask a question for you. Do you see any chances for deleting, removing the law itself?
There is no law in Tunisia.
No law?
And there was no law in Tunisia for blasphemy. I was accused to insult, you know, the person of God, because it's a person, you know. There is no law against blasphemy in Tunisia.
Okay.
And now, okay. In our new constitution, yeah. We suppose, you know, to define our state as a civil state, uh-huh. But our first article is Tunisia, it's a free country. Her religion is Islam, the first thing, you know. Her language, Arabic, and her regime, Republic, you know. So in this one, two, three, you know.
Okay, yeah.
And after, the second article is, it's a civil state, you know. So it's very strange, because you can be accused like me, you know, in justice to insulting the God, and we have now in the article six that we have the free thinking. It's, we are the only Muslim country, I have to say, that we define in our constitution that we have the right to don't believe in God. And nobody has a right to treat you as a kafir, because, you know, in Islam, when you say you are kafir, it means kafir.
Infidel.
Words, you know.
Most of people here.
Infidel, you know, mécréant in French.
Yeah.
And if you treat somebody to be a kafir, you will be judged, you know?
I see, okay.
Because this, it's a sentence of death.
Yes, if you identify the other one as a kafir, then other people can kill him or
but
her.
But this is in the law, this is in the constitution,
okay.
But in the fact, you know, it's different. But I still believe that the law can change mentalities.
Cool. Yeah. Yeah. Final question for you. Do you see any change in the law, for example, in Pakistan?
Right. There's two issues that we're actually discussing here. There's the blasphemy law itself.
Yeah.
And then the blasphemy as a social phenomenon. Yeah. Like blasphemy that a social environment that ends up creating a kind of de facto blasphemy law, even if one does not exist in the state, right? Because you're concerned that you might be killed, that some vigilante will come and they will attack you, they will murder you, your own family. Yeah. And this is something that is global, right? So blasphemy laws are something that exist in some countries, and then there is the global phenomena that we are all concerned with. Even in the West, we have had people who have died because they were exercising their freedom of speech, because they were mocking, they were ridiculing, they were criticizing Islam, they were writing a story, a novel, they were drawing cartoons, and they have paid for that with their lives. So this is the second aspect. This social environment of blasphemy. When it comes to the laws themselves in Pakistan, I mean, I actually am a very optimistic person. I think that positive change can happen anywhere. I mean, if I wasn't a positive person, I probably wouldn't be doing the work that I do. I do believe things can get better. But if we are able to have an international coalition that is focused on this, that comes together and addresses this issue head on, and this has happened in the past, history is filled with examples. When it came to the abolition of slavery, this was something that, you know, 200 years ago was not something that we thought would happen on a global scale the way that it has happened.
Yeah.
people argued even then that this is something that is so entrenched in human society, in human nature. We have had this ever since we have had civilization, and we simply cannot get rid of it. It's too tied to the economy of countries, to the politics of and social reality of certain countries, but that is something that we got rid of. And the international community came together and had a consensus and pressured countries who had slavery and pressured them to abolish it, and it worked. In the Muslim world, I mean, this was very delayed. Saudi Arabia had slaves up until the 1960s. In Mauritania, I think that was the last country to finally criminalize or abolish slavery entirely, and that wasn't until quite recently. Actually, it's pretty shocking, but it happened.
Yeah.
Right, we were able to do it. So this is something that we can come together and do. It's all a matter of us having the courage to stand up and to make this a real possibility.
Okay. By the way, as you probably know, our blasphemy law was deleted in 2014. So it's the fifth year in Holland that we don't have this, you know. So we were, is it good or bad?
Right, I mean, so it's interesting, right? Because you had the blasphemy law up until now, but this is not a country that, up until maybe the Islamist situation, this is not a country that it has experienced blasphemy in the air, right? And the threat of mob violence all around. So there's a social aspect of it that we have to address. There are people that we have to convince so that the machete-wielding extremists, that there are fewer of them, or they don't feel as empowered to do what they're going to do.
Okay. Let me
just one thing. You know, in France, there is no law against blasphemy. But the Islamists in France, they attack, the first time Charlie Hebdo with the caricature of Mahomet in the name of racism. Right. You know, they always find a way, to attack you and to limit your freedoms, you know. So we have to be aware.
Okay, always. Cool. For the last 70 minutes, it's your time to ask some questions, and I will come to you with my microphone, and I will not give the microphone away, as you can understand. I will keep it in my hand. So, please, raise your hand so I can see you. Oh, the first question is for our lawyer. Yeah, okay. Please.
Say. No, I will keep it.
Please stand up, that's the better, yes.
My question from Sarah. You're taking pride that you've left Islam. And why you are writing ex-Muslims? It's a self-contradiction. You have left Islam, and you're still running an organization, ex-Muslims of America. This self-contradiction.
So
how do you explain it?
The idea that I run the organization, or that...
No, I mean...
Ex-Muslim, but you said you left Islam. But
okay.
Ex-Muslim.
Okay, I'm a little bit confused as to what the contradiction is. I mean, I think it's...
Okay, Mr. Lawyer, you have to ask a question.
You have left Islam.
Right.
But still you are writing, we are ex-Muslim.
Oh, why do I associate? Why do I do that? Why do I call myself an ex-Muslim? Yeah. Okay. So this is not an identity label that I love, right? I mean, if I had to call what I am, but just by pure description, I would be an atheist or I would be a humanist, because those are the positive values that now I am attached to. I use the label ex-Muslim because it is illegal to be an ex-Muslim in so many different parts of the world. Yeah. If that reality has changed, then that's a different conversation. But to the extent that it's illegal to be what I am, this is a label that I wear proudly. And it is part of my political protest to say that I'm an ex-Muslim and I have the right to exist and I have the right to leave and to have this as a former identity. Yeah. I mean, to wear that and on my sleeve in the way that you wouldn't if you were just an atheist, any atheist.
Yeah, so you
can
just...
Can I add something to that?
Please.
Well, I used to be a Muslim. Yeah. And when I heard that somebody is an atheist, I always thought that somebody from Hindu religion or Buddhism or Christianity. I never thought that somebody could leave Islam.
Exactly. Yeah.
So until I leave, I knew.
That's exactly right.
I knew only three people who have left Islam.
Yeah.
One of them is sitting in front of me next to you, Dr. Tasliman Ashreen. The other one, Dr. Salman Rushdie, and Dr. Wafa Sultan. Other than that, I didn't know anybody, even Mariam, Sadia, Muhammad. Sarah, I didn't know anybody at the time when I leave. Even I didn't know Amin at
Be
the time.
Be careful, man. So, they are all over the place.
Once I left, I wanted the people know that they can also leave Islam.
Yes.
Even though this, they are threatened with the death, they should get strong and leave Islam. So this is the message that we are delivering to the Muslims. Because there are, I have friends who are still afraid to call themselves ex-Muslims. They are still afraid to come out of Islam.
Yeah.
Just they are pretending. They don't have any faith.
Yeah.
But they cannot come out. It's in Sri Lanka. I know, I have my friends. But they cannot come out.
Okay.
So
Nadia.
Just we are passing the positive message.
I got. Nadia.
Because for me, it's I was never a believer, you know. But in Islam, you've born Muslim.
Yeah.
Because your father is Muslim.
Yeah.
And my father is, his grandfather was an imam, you know, and all the family was, you know, very respecting all these things of Islam. But I because we had this discussion with Mariam a lot of time at the beginning when we met, but I didn't want at this time to be called as an ex-Muslim, because I said I was never a believer, you know. No Muslim and no Christian and nothing. And but it's to let people know from where I'm coming, you know.
I understand.
It's like neither Allah nor Master. It's not ni Dieu ni Maître.
Yeah.
It's ni Allah ni Maître. It's to know from where I am talking.
Okay. Okay. Questions. FK. Okay. Please stand up. Yes, please stand up. Okay.
Hi, my name is Jamal. I'm from ex-Muslims of Norway. I want to ask you. You know, if I say Islam is the most ridiculous, most absurd, and most intolerant and bloody religion in the world, which affected the world. And we have to remove it. Then, in the Westerners' eyes, I'm a hater or bigotry I'm making. But this quote is Voltaire's quote. Just changed the Islam with Christianity, and he said more than 250 or more than 200 years ago. He said Christianity is the most absurd, ridiculous, and the bloodiest religion which affected the world, and we have to remove it. And he didn't mean kill it. So I want to ask you, you guys, especially Rishvin, you are from Sri Lanka, and you are in the front line, because you have not so much protection as we have here. But what is the problem with the Western liberals? That they're not focusing the problem. We have one problem with the blasphemy in the last 1400 years, and this is the reason Islam is existing today. But why they don't ignore this, not focusing, not supporting the ex-Muslim movements, but they are busy with Islamophobia? Why?
Okay, good. Especially
well,
for you, Shivit.
Well, Jamal, your last touch, Islamophobia. I would say that Islamophobia protect Islam better than any other weapons, even better than Kalashnikov, swords, suicide bombers, better than any other weapons. The term Islamophobia, I don't know who invented that one. But it's the best invention. Even Muhammad failed to do that one. But somebody invented that one. And it protects Islam very well. And we are also victim of being called Islamophobic, even in Sri Lanka. Within minority, a minority within a minority. We are being accused of this one.
Okay. By the way, correct me if I'm wrong. I guess I read something. You had the same remark or same.
Yeah, I talk about this all the time.
Yeah,
it's a big, you know because I'm in the United States and we work in the United States, and we also had this experience of soon after the founding of our organization and taking a lot of steps that were terrifying to all of us. We found that we were lodged with the Islamophobia label and the bigotry, and a lot of it was coming from people who I believe still to be just, you know, well-meaning but confused liberals who don't understand what it is exactly that we're facing here and what it is exactly that we're fighting.
Yeah.
But so part of our additional fight, the struggle that we have to do, in addition to everything else, in addition to the Islamists, is also to educate the West and help them understand what religion is, what Islam is, what bigotry truly means.
Yeah.
And it's, you know, the idea is absurd at the very face of it. when you have experienced personally people, you know, who are fundamentalists and very religious, telling you that you are not allowed to be gay, you are, you know, disgusting and sinful if you live a certain life, if you are a woman who is free and who lives by herself. I mean, when you've experienced these kinds of things, you know the absurdity of the charge of bigotry that is lodged also against ex-Muslims. So I hope, you know, that this will change in the future.
Yeah, especially for our especially for our leftish liberal friends to understand your situation. Yeah. Okay, Daria, please stand up. Okay. Squeeze me. Yes. Thank you.
Hi, my name is Michael. I have a question for Sarah. I would like to know your opinion on migration policies. How do you think it should work in the future? Are you for open the borders, or are you for European quotas, or do you think it should be handled individually by specific countries? How should integration work?
And Sarah, keep in mind that, you know, it's not really related to our main concept of today, you know, about blasphemy, so...
Short.
Please.
Yeah, well, it's a, you know, we can talk about that afterwards, I think, when it's on.
So I will link you up. Okay.
Time, right?
Yeah. Over here. Please stand up. Yes. Thank you. Yes.
Hi, good afternoon. My question is to Mr. Ishvin, is Matt. Would you please? Because it's very close.
To understand you.
It's nice scream, okay? Okay, just a question. We know that in Islam, blasphemy differs. To other forms, yeah, like in from different contexts, like in Europe, for instance. For example, drawing Muhammad is in itself blasphemy. Drawing Muhammad, but many people don't know this. So you go so far making a cartoon, etc. So so blasphemy is. In the Muslim culture, is linked to a lot of things, like for instance, to women's situation in society, to sometimes to hijab, to niqab. If you criticize these things, you are aduwallah. So it's already blasphemy. So you, as a man, do you criticize only God and Muhammad or all the culture? You see what I mean? All that's linked to you as a privileged person. You are a man, of course, you have very privileges from women, etc. Do you criticize, I mean, all these, all the culture that you come from?
Yeah, we do. Or not only Muhammad and God. Whatever you mentioned, that we do, whenever there's a platform and necessary arises, we do that. When I said we, because in Sri Lanka, we have an organization for ex-Muslims, Council of Ex-Muslims of Sri Lanka, and we do that one. And very recently, we've been advocating against removing certain law that set for Muslims only Muslim Marriage and Divorce Act. We are voicing for one law for all because we don't want Muslim women to be treated as second-class citizen according to, under that law.
Cool. We have 5 minutes. We have only 5 minutes, and I see at least 7 hands. So, and someone says, no, come to her. Okay, we'll come to you. And please stand up. Thank you. Okay, please.
Hiya. Sue Bichon, BBC News. I wanted to speak to you, Sarah. It's really strange because I've been trying to get hold of you. I've been talking to Muhammad on and off on Facebook for a while. So it's good that you're here. I just wondered, what sort of reaction or support do you get as an organization from practicing Muslims who don't actually agree with the bigotry you're fighting against, people who have no problem with homosexuality or sex outside of marriage? How do those people relate to you?
It's complicated, I think, and I understand why they might feel conflicted with assisting us or helping us, but we do have progressive Muslims, very liberal Muslims who are in contact with our organization, who we can work together once in a while when it's feasible. It's not something that happens regularly or routinely, unfortunately. This is something that, you know, it's... I think, and the way that I feel is that sometimes progressive Muslim organizations see us as a greater enemy almost, because they see us as people who, because we point to the problems in Islam in the religion directly. And I think that for people who are trying to say, oh no, Islam is actually, it promotes feminism. It's Muhammad was the first feminist. And, you know, for people who are trying to push that line of thought, that Islam is truly this religion which can improve or already has improved, already essentially is more human rights focused than it is, or it's been perverted in some way in the modern world. For people who hold that viewpoint, we are, to some degree, the position we hold is something that is oppositional to them.
Okay. We have only room for one final question. So it's up to you. One final question. Is your question deserves to be the final one? Really, yeah? You too? Oh my God, I have a problem, okay. You know, I come just to you, you know, the first row, you know, okay? So the final question, please stand up. Please. Yes, yes, please, yes, yes, yeah, okay.
Please stand up.
Please stand up, okay.
I can't touch it?
No.
Really?
Yeah.
Do I get a penalty?
No, no, ask your question.
So my question's directly, for Rishvin, actually. So we talk about the liberals that we often let off the hook, actually, and I think that's really wrong too, because I don't think they're as ignorant or as innocent as they claim to be. They are just fucking racist. What do you think of them as somebody who's not having to deal with necessarily those liberals that will make excuses for our perpetrators? What do you think about them? Do you have any thoughts?
Well, your question is not much clear to me. Can you put it in a different way?
So people that often make excuses for our perpetrators, those that the actual fundamentalists, but or like the various kinds of Muslims that will say, you know, Islam is a feminist religion or Islam, or use that term Islamophobia and accuse us of inflaming Islamophobia, those liberals, what do you think about them? Does that make a bit more sense?
You're asking about the Muslim liberals.
No. I'm asking about non-Muslim liberals.
Well,
that will
I often wonder whether they are the victim of the Muslim apologists, or they're purposely doing this one in order to keep Islam grow, and they can say that we have a better life and see these Muslims, they're always having this kind of shitty life. I always wonder, because after the bomb blast in Sri Lanka, that Muslims started thinking about their religion, okay, what it is in, and why these people blasted bombs. And they killed themselves, so it can't be a job that they did for money. So they sacrificed their lives. And if you look at the videos, most of the suicide bombers walking very happily. So there was something behind that one. Then Muslims started thinking. But in this time, the liberals, the left, so-called left, come in and say it. Muslims have. We were advocating like Muslims have to think about the religion and have to question about these things. They said, no, you don't have the right. You don't have the right. Let them have their own decision. They have the right to follow the religion. Then I questioned them. Do you say that they have the right to blast bombs and commit suicide, and carrying on suicide attacks? Do you want them to do this one? So they didn't directly answer. Even, I'll tell you one example, after the bomb blast, there was a document leaked, sent by the Indian intelligence to the Sri Lankan police, that there's going to be a bomb blast by this Islamic movement, so-and-so individuals are going to have this attack on this day. But this document leaked the very next day because it didn't reach the top position in Sri Lanka. I don't know, it's a lot of political things, I don't know. Okay, but left was the first to say, this is a fact document. They just put a stamp on this one and share, this is a fake document. But later on, the next day, the government acknowledged, yes, it was a real document. But even the dust or the smoke from the bombs didn't settle, but these people were very fast to jump and say that this is a fake document and Islam and Muslims have nothing to do with this one.
So to put it very short, you are not happy with those liberal leftish people and their support of the Islam. Am I right, yeah?
Not support of Islam, because of their activity to keep the Islamic terrorism and the fundamentalism alive.
Okay,
of
cool.
Of course not happy.
Clearly, clear, clear, okay. Okay, I'm going to wrap up. So it means Nadia, Sarah, Rishvin, thank you so much for being here. Miss Saif just left the building, I guess. Our lawyer left the building. And Veedu Vidz, the musician. Okay, over there. Thank you, Veedu. Okay. And I would like to thank the people who made this program on the background, Sophie Rutenfrans, Ianta Mosselman, and Mariam Lemazier. Thank you so much for organizing this. And thank you for your very smart and clear question. Thank you, especially you. Thank you. Okay. On that note, enjoy your evening. The bar is lost. Thank you, well. Thank you, well. Thank you. Thank you.
Thank you.
Thank you. Thank you. Strong. Strong.